During the Ebb Software Conference, you talk a lot about exponential times and era. What do you mean by that?
Well, at Singularity University, when we talk about exponential times, and we're in them right now, we're talking about the rise of technologies like computers, networks, and sensors, which are leading to the IoTs of this world. We're talking about the rise of artificial intelligence. We're talking about the rise of digital biology, so the ability to edit and change life. We're talking about the rise of robotic technology that not is just at the physical large form, but even nanorobotics and nanotechnology. And we're talking about the rise of digital manufacturing or additive manufacturing, more commonly known as 3D printing. And underneath all of that is the growth of the amount of computing power that you can get per dollar, that you can get an exponentially rising amount of computing power per dollar. You can get sensors that are getting cheaper and cheaper and cheaper to perceive the world. You can get a democratized access to artificial intelligence. And all of these are starting to shift at an ongoing rate and at an accelerating rate the amount that can be done for any given amount of dollars. And that's sort of what we talk about when we're talking about exponential times.
And how companies should be prepared for that? I mean, if they don't embrace this exponential times, they will be just lag behind.
How do companies prepare for this? The first thing they do is that they accept that it's coming. Okay, I mean that's the easiest thing. We're in a new world, right? And that world is going to keep changing. These technologies are not going to stop. They're not going to stay where they are, right? They're going to get stronger and stronger and stronger. And you can look at it two different ways. You can say, that is a huge threat for me and my company, or you can look at it and say, wow, that's an enormous opportunity. And you can start to say to yourself, what within our company that today is almost the critical thing that we do, if that becomes commoditized, which it could, what business are we now in and what business are we really in? And you really need to, we advise companies to really go out into the future, go out 15 years, right? And start to imagine what the world would be like out in that space. Imagine what you'd like it to be like out in that space. And then start to say, where are we playing in that space? And then track back from that time to today and let that inform you. What is the thing that we should be doing now that is putting us on the path to success forward? So it is that exercise. Go out into the future. Solve the present from the future, not the future from the present. Don't use today's mindset and say that's what the future looks like. Go out there and then come back and find your path to it. It's critically important.
But this shift of mentality, it's a huge process. And what is the impact of all of this in the future of work?
I wasn't expecting that question. The future work is interesting, right? The future of work is a very complex topic. One of the first things to... So if you go back to the Oxford Martin study, one of the first studies that came out that indicated how much of... employment would change, right? It's been heavily misinterpreted as this is the number of people that will be unemployed. Really, it's more of a mark, and you're seeing this more and more, of what skills will become redundant, right? And so what you're starting to see is that the future of work is constant change, right? For any individual and an organization, it's the ability to constantly go with this change, right? We hear about, you know, being resilient, right? But this doesn't feel that good, right? Really what you have to be is to be able to adapt and be in the flow of that change. And so the future of work for those who have work will be in the space of how much of my time is doing the task at hand and how much of my time is reskilling for the future. A study came out a little earlier this year, I believe it was, or end of last year, that 52% of the current skills will be no longer needed by 2022. I think that number is a bit high, but that is an ongoing cycle. So you have to get into the cycle of learning and relearning and relearning, unlearning some old skills, relearning some new skills, and that's what the future of working is like. The other part of the future of work that we hear is about the automation, right? Our job's going to disappear. And we've seen this before, right? If you take a look at the automotive industry, if you go to an automotive plant today, if you went to an automotive plant in 1958, before the first robot came into an automotive plant, which I believe was 1961, it was full of men riveting and putting stuff together. Today, if you go to an automated plant, it's almost fully automated, right? So those sort of jobs increasingly go away. Now, there's a way of looking at that, though. If you take a look at your car from 1958, I know you didn't have a car in 58, but maybe your family did, right? And you take a look at your car now is an incredible machine, right, that you can afford. So the truth is that there is a decreasing cost in almost everything. It's decreasing marginal cost in production, decreased in cost. So things become more affordable. That's another way of looking at it. There is a gap at the moment, right? And that gap is, as we're transitioning to sort of a newer world, there are people that are going to be automated out, right? And the question is, how many of them? And then the question, which I think is a critical question, is what is the society you want to live in? You know, how do you feel about those people? Because if I'm personally am a believer that if you don't look after them, that is going to come back into your society in a negative way. So how do we provide for the people who are either in transition? Universal basic income may be one of those answers. And that transition has two sort of different elements to it. Are we going to provide universal basic income or a way for people to sustain themselves indefinitely? Or are we going to provide the sort of universal basic income that says, look, for the next 4 years is what it's going to take for me to even take a step function up to then be in the cycle mode? Are we going to be universal basic income from that and enable people to ebb and flow through? The other thing that we need to keep in mind is that we need a different mental model of what the future is going to be, because currently we look at our economy as it is. A lot of economies are sitting at a low agrarian percentage, around 16-17% manufacturing. A whole big chunk of it is services sector. If you went back 100 years, it didn't look like that at all. The services sector has ballooned as people have found new ways of providing services to each other, using technology often to facilitate that. There's a whole other thing that we can't even imagine that is going to be an economic contributor that is sitting on top of this. The question is, how do we get there, and how do we look after everybody as we're moving forward? And I think that's critically important.